bitterness Jacob understood was unworthy, the result of having himself no survivors, male or otherwise. Now that his daughter, Patricia, had followed her dead brothers, there was no one yet to reap the modest but respectable inheritance he hoped to accumulate. Thus tempting envy, as taught in the poorhouse, Jacob entertained himself by conjuring up flaws in the couple's marriage. They seemed well suited for each other, vain, voluptuous, prouder of their pewter and porcelain than of their sons. It was abundantly clear why Ortega was in serious debt, turning profit into useless baubles, unembarrassed by sumptuary, silk stockings and overdressed wife. Wasting candles in midday, he would always be unable to ride out any setback, whether it be lost ship or ruined crop. Watching the couple, Jacob noticed that husband and wife never looked at each other, except for a stolen glance when the other looked elsewhere. He could not tell what was in those surreptitious beaks, but it amused him to divine the worst while he endured the foolish, incomprehensible talk and inedible dishes. They did not smile, they sneered, did not laugh, giggled. He imagined them vicious with servants and obsequious with priests. His initial embarrassment about the unavoidable consequences of his long journey, muddy boots, soiled hands, perspiration and its odor, yuck, was dimmed by the mistress Ortega's loud perfume and heavily powdered face. The only, if minor, relief came from the clove-smelling woman who brought the food. His own Rebecca seemed ever more valuable to him, the rare times he was in the company of these rich men's wives, women who changed frocks every day and dressed their servants in sacking. From the moment he saw his bride-to-be struggling down the gangplank with bedding, two boxes, and a heavy satchel, he knew his good fortune. He had been willing to accept a bag of bones or an ugly maiden, in fact expected one, since a pretty one would have had several local opportunities to wed. But the young woman who answered his shout in the crowd was plump, comely, and capable. Worth every day of the long search made necessary because taking over the patroon sheep required a wife, and because he wanted a certain kind of mate, an unchurched woman of childbearing age, obedient but not groveling, literate but not proud, independent but nurturing. And he would accept no scald. Just as the first mate's report described her, Rebecca was ideal. There was not a shrewish bone in her body. She never raised her voice in anger, saw to his needs, made the tenderest dumplings, took to chores in a land completely strange to her with enthusiasm and invention, cheerful as a bluebird. Or used to be. Three dead infants in a row, followed by the accidental death of Patricia, their five-year-old, had unleavened her. A kind of invisible ash had settled over her, which vigils at the small graves in the meadow did nothing to wipe away. Yet, she neither complained nor shirked her duties. If anything, she threw herself more vigorously into the farm work, and when she traveled, as now, on business, trading, collecting, lending, he had no doubts about how his home was being managed. Rebecca and her two helpers were as reliable as sunrise and as strong as posts. Besides, time and health were on their side. He was confident she would bear more children, and at least one, a boy, would live to thrive. Dessert, applesauce and pecans. Applesauce and pecans was an improvement. and when he accompanied Ortega on the impossible-to-refuse tour of the place, his mood has lifted slightly. Enough to admire the state, honestly. The mist had cleared, and he was able to see in detail the workmanship and care of the tobacco sheds, wagons, row after row of barrels, orderly and nicely kept. The well-made meat house, milk house, laundry, cookhouse, all but the last, whitewashed plaster, a jot smaller than the slave quarters, but, unlike them, in excellent repair. The subject, the purpose of the meeting, had not been approached. Ortega had described with attention to minute detail the accidents beyond his control that made him unable to pay what he owed, but how Jacob would be reimbursed had not been broached. Examining the spotted, bug-ridden leaves of tobacco, it became clear that Ortega had left to offer slaves. Jacob refused. His farm was modest. His trade needed only himself. Besides having no place to put them, there was nothing to occupy them. "Ridiculous," said Ortega. "You sell them. Do you know the prices they garner?" Jacob winced. Flesh was not his commodity. Still, at his host's insistence, he trailed him to the little sheds where Ortega interrupted their half-day's rest and ordered some 24 or more to assemble in a straight line, including the boy who had watered Regina. The two men walked a row, inspecting, Ortega identifying talents, weaknesses, and possibilities, but silent about the scars, the wounds like misplaced veins tracing their skin. One even had the facial brand required by local law when a slave assaulted a white man a second time. The women's eyes looked shockproof, gazing beyond place and time as though they were not actually there. The men looked at the ground, except every now and then, when possible, and they thought they were not being evaluated. Jacob could see their quick glances sideways, wary, but most of all judging the men who judged them. Suddenly, Jacob felt his stomach seize. The tobacco odor, so welcoming when he arrived, now nauseated him. Or was it the sugared rice, the hog cuts fried and dripping with molasses, the cocoa lady Ortega's was so giddy about? Whatever it was, he couldn't stay there, surrounded by a passel of slaves whose silence made him imagine an avalanche seen from a great distance. No sound, just the knowledge of a roar he could not hear. He begged off, saying the proposal was not acceptable. Too much trouble to transport, manage, auction. His solitary, unencumbered proficiency was what he liked about trade. Specie, bills of credit, quit claims were portable. One satchel carried all he needed. They walked back toward the house and through the side gate in the ornate fence, Ortega pontificating all the while. He would do the selling. Pounds? Spanish sovereigns? He would arrange the transportation, hire the handler. Stomach turning, nostrils assailed, Jacob grew angry. This is a calamity, he thought. Unresolved, it will lead to years in a lawsuit in a province ruled by the king's judges, disinclined to favor a distant tradesman over a local Catholic gentleman. The loss, while not unmanageable, struck him as unforgivable. And to such a man, Ortega's strut as they had walked the property disgusted him. Moreover, he believed the set of that jaw, the drooping lids, hid something soft, as if his hands, accustomed to reins, whips, and lays, had never held a plow or axed a tree. There was something beyond Catholic in him, something sordid and overripe. But what could he do? Jacob felt the same of his weakened position, like a soiling of the blood. No wonder they had been excluded from Parliament back home, and although he did not believe they should be hunted down like vermin, other than on business, he would never choose to mingle or socialize with the lowest or highest of them. Barely listening to Ortega's patter, sly, indirect, instead of straight and manly, Jacob neared the cookhouse and saw a woman standing in the doorway with two children, one on her hip, one hiding behind her skirts. She looked healthy enough, better fed than the others. On a whim, mostly to silence him and fairly sure Ortega would refuse, he said, "Her, that one, I'll take her." Ortega stopped short, a startled look on his face. "Ah, no, impossible. My wife won't allow it. She can't live without her. She's our main cook, the best one." Jacob drew closer and, recognizing a clove-laced sweat, suspected there was more than cooking Ortega stood to lose. "You said any. I could choose any. If your word is worthless, there's only the law." Ortega lifted an eyebrow, just one, as though on its curve an empire rested. Jacob knew he was struggling with his impertinent threat from an inferior, but he must have thought better of returning the insult with another. He desperately wanted this business over quickly, and he wanted his way. "Well, yes," said Ortega, "but there are other women here, more. You see them? Also, this one is nursing."
"Then the law it is," said Jacob.
Ortega smiled. A lawsuit would certainly be decided in his favor, and the time wasted in pursuing it would be to his advantage. "You astound me," he said. Jacob refused to back down. "Perhaps another lender would be more to your liking," he said, and enjoyed seeing the nostril flare that meant he had struck home. Ortega was notorious for unpaid debts and had to search far outside Maryland for a broker, since he had exhausted his friends and local lenders, refused what they knew would be inevitable default. The air tightened. "You don't seem to comprehend my offer. I'm not forfeiting my debt. I'm honoring it. The value of a seasoned slave is beyond adequate. Not if I can't use her. Use her. Sell her." "My trade is goods and gold, sir," said Jacob. And he could not resist adding, "But I understand how hard it is for a papist to accommodate certain kinds of restraint." "Too subtle?" wondered Jacob. "Not at all, apparently," for Ortega's hand moved to his hip. Jacob's eyes followed the movement as the ringed fingers curled around the scabbard. Would he, with this curdled, arrogant fop, really assault his creditor, murder him, and claiming self-defense prerogative, rid himself of both debt and social insult, even though it would mean complete financial disaster, considering that his coffers were as empty as his scabbard? The soft fingers fumbled for the absent haft. Jacob raised his eyes to Ortega's, noticing the cowardice of unarmed gentry confronted with a commoner. Out here in wilderness, dependent on paid guards nowhere in sight this Sunday, he felt like laughing. Where else but in this disorganized world would such an encounter be possible?
Where else could rank tremble before courage? Jacob turned away, letting his exposed, unarmed back convey his scorn. It was a curious moment. Along with his contempt, he felt a wave of exhilaration. Potent, steady, an inside shift from careful negotiator to the raw boy that once prowled the lanes of town and country. He did not even try to mute his chuckling as he passed the cookhouse and glanced again at the woman standing in its door.